The bioscience sector is one of the most innovative industries in the U.S. As of 2016, bioscience and healthcare represent a $37 billion industry in San Antonio, Texas. Today, we will hear from successful researchers, faculty, and entrepreneurs at UT Health San Antonio, who are actively involved in innovation, and some who will share their story of the path to commercialization. Dr. Felon, I show that you hold 18 issued patents in the United States, Canada, Australia, two allowed patent applications, 13 pending patent applications. You've been a part of three startup companies, one of which was acquired by a major corporation. A third startup, Admittance Technologies, as a part of the UT Horizon Fund portfolio. And you're a collaborator with UT Austin College of Engineering. That's impressive. Take us back to the first one. Now, there had to be a beginning. And what was that process with the very first patent and the first process?
Well, yeah, one of the first processes were working with Thomas Milner, a professor at UT Austin. We began using light to image mouse hearts just as a way to see the heart contract and relax. It's such a small heart, it's hard to do that with other technologies. And then we realized, we had the insight that maybe we could actually put that into a human coronary artery and see the same resolution, look for plaques that actually could rupture and cause heart attacks. And so that transition in that sort of insight allowed us to then focus no longer just on mice, but also then began getting access to human hearts and actually realizing that we could actually identify these thin cap fiber atheromas, the basis where when they rupture, they cause heart attacks. And up to that point, you could not image these thin cap fiber atheromas in live patients. They were only seen at autopsy, but it was known that they rupture. And so our group and also a group in Boston at the same time began imaging those in patients and also ex vivo human hearts. And we began realizing that we could see those before they rupture and maybe try to warn of a future heart attacks for the first time.
But give us a sense of the journey. Where did this begin and how did we get to nearly three dozen patents?
I think the key is these brainstorming sessions. So we would meet weekly or biweekly in the School of Engineering at UT Austin. We'd have one or two professors present. We'd have graduate students present. We'd have myself and either medical students or trainees, medical residents present, sometimes cardiology fellows. And we would just have debates about ideas and just having clinicians and engineers together in the same room, the clinicians to point out the clinical problems, and then the engineers to suggest solutions on how to solve them. We would then basically come up with some unique ideas, and that's when we realized that we were generating IP or the basis for patent application.
Dr. Mubarry is professor in the Department of Pharmacology and the School of Medicine at UT Health San Antonio. She's co-leader, Experimental and Developmental Therapeutics Program at CTRC, the Cancer Therapy and Research Center, and at UT Health. Dr. Mubarry, welcome. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Your research is dedicated to trying to find more effective therapies for the treatment of cancer. That's a really broad area. Help us narrow it down and tell me what you do.
Sure. Well, my lab is involved in finding new drugs for the treatment of cancer, but we're not going after every single cancer because, as you say, cancer is a very, very complex disease. So we're looking specifically at the types of cancer that we haven't had very effective targeted therapies for. So, for example, we're looking at some types of breast cancer that are just not responsive to the types of targeted therapies that are available to many women. And we're taking that pie and cutting it into pieces so that we find very specific drugs that could work against the molecular drivers that are turning those different cancers on so that we can stop the gas pedal on those.
This is not a single person's initiative, and when these drug therapies emerge, generally there are a lot of hands on them.
Oh, there's so many hands on it. Even at the level of where we are now with early discovery, there's so many people. I have this fantastic laboratory group that works very closely together. And, you know, that's really what it takes is a team. And then as things get more optimistic for thinking about a drug candidate, then you even bring in more people. And science today is very, very collaborative, and the ability to collaborate well with others is very, very important part of a scientific career. You know, part of being an entrepreneur and a scientist today is to not let these artificial barriers hold you back, and take the chance and go approach somebody and say, I'd like to collaborate.
Tell us about bioaffinity and why you're here in this collaboration.
We are working with Dr. Alex Pertsimalidis, who's here with us today, in development and commercialization of some very exciting technology in cancer. Our technology is not simply one that can be directed towards lung cancer. It's a technology that can be used in multiple cancers. Some of the work that we've done with UT Health has illuminated, has helped us to discover the mechanism by which our compound, our test works. And what it has led us to believe is that our test works in multiple cancers.
Most of what we're doing is in the dish. So we have a number of cell line models of different types of lung cancer and different pediatric cancers. Some of these are known to be drug responsive, some are known to be drug resistant. Some have other interesting features. Some are neuroendocrine, some are not neuroendocrine. We also have a series of models of normal cells. These are immortalized normal human epithelial cells for the lung cancer case, and we're working on developing models of normal cells for the neuroblastoma case. And the idea is, at least in one iteration of these experiments, is to combine these in different amounts, possibly in the context of a sputum sample, and see the degree to which TCPP detects the cancer cells, detects the normal cells, which we hope is not the case. Nothing we find in the lab, nothing we discover, nothing we develop, nothing we publish will ever help a single patient without the collaboration of industry. That there is so much more to creating a product, to marketing it, to getting it out into the clinic than what an academic lab can do. That partnership is actually required.
We specifically came, we looked all over the country for the team that we wanted to develop this. And we met with a doctor who is now our chief medical and science officer. So we did take her. Who is Dr. Vivian Rebell. She's an MD, PhD.
Who'd been on faculty at UT Health.
That's correct. And actually very, very few institutions have the depth of researchers. You know, Vivian has come to work for us, and we have an equally great researcher in Dr. Pertsimalidis to further the commercialization of this assay.
When do you know that a product is ready for patenting? You know, what are the signs?
The first step is, you know, it's just the same basic skills we use when doing research. You have to know the literature. You have to make sure that what you're doing is unique. So there are not other research papers on the same concept. You then also have to know how to search the U.S. Patent Office for lists of patents, and you look at different types of patents that other people have filed. But when you actually file the patent application, the patent office will then send you back a list of patents that they think are competitive with what you're doing or similar, and then you have to then argue why yours are unique and different. So it's quite a long process to actually get a patent filed and issued. You ultimately depend on the engineers that you work with, because oftentimes these are very subtle points that differentiate you from other patents, and really the engineers are critical in reading the other groups' patents and pointing out why our patents are unique. And we've been successful ultimately in getting a lot of our patents through that have been questioned.
So in that process, who owns the intellectual property?
The patents are all owned by the UT system. So for instance, when you spin out a company and you actually license those patents into the company from the UT system. The university encourages entrepreneurship by allowing half the royalties, for instance, coming in to go to the inventors and half to go to the UT system.
There was a time when it was principally NIH funding. Is that correct?
Well, no, there's been originally NIH and American Heart. We've also been fortunate enough to work with the Clayton Foundation in Houston. So the Clayton Foundation is a foundation that supports researchers at all the UT component institutions. They invest in in research. The hope is that then patents are filed and companies will be spun off one day. And so there's a biomedical company arm to Clayton as well. But you know, once you have some initial successes, then you're able to talk to foundations like the Clayton Foundation and also get them interested as well.
And NIH funding, though, has been in decline until now. I suppose the new budget does allow for something over $30 billion, and it shows an increase. How will that impact your research?
No, it makes us, it just gives us more encouragement to continue to apply to NIH. We currently have NIH funding for one of our proposals with the admittance, the heart failure warning system. But it, you know, because funding is now getting a little bit easier, you know, it encourages us to apply for new NIH grants.
How is this funded?
It's funded through private investors who see the benefit of this. We have probably about 25 very good investors.
Is it VC capital?
It is not. It is a family, high net worth individuals, many of whom have been touched by cancer. All of them are in the pharmaceutical or have been in the pharmaceutical business. On my board of directors is former presidents of large pharmaceuticals. My chairman of the board, Steve Girgenti, for example, has taken two companies, he likes to say from his garage, but I'm sure it wasn't from his garage, but two world-leading companies in the pharmaceutical and medical marketing areas. BioAffinity Technologies is a small, privately held company that is just beginning its commercialization efforts, actually next year, and will be doing so with UT Health. The first product will be a non-invasive early lung cancer test, which is sorely needed. As you may know, lung cancer is the leading killer, cancer killer, in the United States and worldwide. And much of the reason that it has such an abysmal survival rate, people who get it, 60% die within the first year, is because it's caught so late. So our technology is focused on catching it early, catching it in a non-invasive manner, and treating it early so that we get higher, much higher survival rates.
Dr. Fulman, when you consulted with the Office of Technology Commercialization at UT Health San Antonio, help us understand the kind of support they've given you.
They're very, very helpful. One is they give you advice on when you should apply for a patent. Two is they have expertise in patents, and they can sometimes help you write parts of the claims and the body of the patent. It saves money for everyone if the inventors can actually participate in the patent writing application process, and they can advise you on how to do that. And third, they have connections in the community, so they often know of investors or foundations that you could that you can talk to and dialogue with that may possibly be investors in the company. So they're of great value in this whole process. You know, have a big idea, and then try to and read the literature, and then find collaborators to help you solve those problems. As you develop ideas, you know, file patents first, because if you publish a paper first, then you can't file a patent. So the first step is to file a patent through the UT system that's assigned to the UT system, then abstracts to get your ideas out at national meetings, and then the last step would be publishing papers. And then just keep that process going and apply for competitive grants at NIH and the American Heart Association. But when you get to a critical mass of patents and the Office of Technology Ventures can help you decide when that is, you could then spin out a company and then place all those patents, you know, into the company that are licensed from the UT system.
Drugs today can't be as good as the drugs that are out there. You have to be better. So if you look at models that are drug resistant early on and say, you know, can we be better than the drugs that are out there? Ask that question. And if you can be, then that gives you the impetus to go forward. You may not make it. Your drug or your device may not make it to the final steps, but just even going that process is a very rewarding and very fulfilling series of events, and a lot of it is out of your control, and part of it is knowing, you know, when to stop, when you have control of things, and then when you have to let it go to the people that have more expertise.
An early understanding of the potential relationships between academic labs and companies is not only important, but critical to the idea of being able to do something positive to affect human health.